So I grew up in Hawaii on Oahu, and my dad is a cooperative builder, you guys know. His name's Bobby Puke. He has his own foundation. He still teaches the art of co-op canoes and rebuilding a lot of the canoes that people want to remodify and stuff. And my grandfather built canoes, so I kind of got into canoe paddling when I was 16. I was a late bloomer. I didn't want to surf. I don't know. Then he made me work on the canoes. I'm like, I don't work. I don't want to go surfing, right? And now I build canoes and teach paddling. So how I got into coaching was in 1986, I was training for the 88 Olympics. Kayak, sprint, K1. I got injured, and I was going well, you know, probably would have made it. And then I had a bad injury in 89, I started coaching kayaking. And Olympic kayaking is really a very technical sport. The K1, I don't know if you guys ever seen a K1. There's a couple here, Lauren trained in it, she made the Olympic team. Pat Dolan, one more guy, he's trains in that. The water line's about this wide on the bottom. So if anybody tries to sit in one, and you're upside down, like right there. And you sit in them like it's almost like a river kayak, but they're long and super narrow and skinny and fast. And your technique has to be perfect. Like every movement moves the boat. And they say 5 years to get good at it. You know, the people from Hawaii, a lot of times in 2 years, they're pretty good at it, swimming in the ocean and stuff all the time. So that was kind of my gig. And I had really good technique, and then I got hurt in 89. 86, 89, I started coaching. I ran the Hawaii Canoe Kayak Team in the national team program for Olympic stuff for about 10 years for the U.S. So I learned a lot about technique, and I started applying it to canoeing. I just kind of reluctantly, I didn't really want to coach canoe paddling. We'll talk about that later. But, and so since I knew technique and efficiency so well, it was easier to bring it to another sport. I coached the Wienalo women team Bradley for a long time. A couple teams in the mainland, Newport Aquatic Center and Dana Point, they were very successful in the last few years, winning, you know, Catalina and stuff like that. Actually, the NAC guys, Newport guys that I coached for 3 years went to Tahiti last year, not for Hawaii Team League, but for that other race, and ran head-to-head with Shell. And these were just like, I don't know if you guys saw it on TV, it was pretty fun to watch. They were right there. Shell was probably not pushing as hard as they had to, but at least they're in the game, right? Anyway, so I've been coaching for a long time, and about 5 years ago, I decided to take a break. I felt like I wasn't learning anymore. The Tahitians were doing so well. And then I met two really good friends of mine now. One is Teva from Paddling Connections, one of the best teams in Tahiti, because he's in and out of California. He's a flight attendant. So he would paddle with us for 2 or 3 days every 2 weeks and teach us. And then Gerard from Shell, their coach, for all those 10 years, he spends like a month at a time in Newport. So I got to know those guys real well, play music, drink beer, paddle with them, and they taught me what the Tahitians were doing. So I kind of got to learn from them, and I'm applying it now. Let's make a really long story short. Because it's a really long story. But anyway, so from what I hear and what I watched from the women yesterday, you guys are kind of working on being a little longer in the water, a little quicker in the air, right?
Correct.
Everybody's buying in, right? Nobody's like stuck in the old days. Okay. So it's interesting because when I started working with Gerard, he said a lot of things to me that they said at the Olympic Training Center for kayaking. Set the blade, pull the boat to that point. Patience on the catch is what the Polish coaches that were some of the best in the world that we worked with. You know, move the blade, same speed as the boat. You know, and the Tahitians are teaching the same thing. You know, back 7 years ago, I was teaching, you know, that whole quick in the water, slow in the air thing, like the opposite tempo. And where that came from was really K1, when I think about it, you know, because the K1s are really fast. I mean, they go 1,000 meters in 3 minutes. I mean, they're quick. You know, K4, a four-man kayak, 120 strokes a minute, perfect timing, and they'll actually pull a water skier up with a harness on the guy. on the 4C. So they're really, I mean, for 500 or 1,000 meters, they're the fastest manpower craft. You know, but we taught there time in the air. And when I look back at it, it's since the boat was so fast, you could be quicker in the water because you're moving quicker. And you waited longer before the boat slowed down and you caught it. Right? And then so it's like at 80, 90 strokes a minute, you're going quick through the water because you're going quicker. And you're catching the wave. You know, it's just like right before it slows down, you want to grab that boat again. So you have less resistance. So we were teaching that quick in the water, slow in the air, you know, kind of like we did in K1. And then rowing is the same thing, you know, 32 strokes a minute, 35 strokes a minute. You catch long oars, everybody pulls one time, boat gets moving, they wait, and just right before the boat slows down, they try to catch it again. Right, so that's the theory. And then we were teaching this at six man, which worked because no one else was doing anything different, right? And the Hawaiians were good in the surf, and we would them all the time now and then. But when I started working with the Tahitians, they were saying, slow in the water, slow in the water, right? And you look at it, you've got this really fat, heavy 400-pound boat dragging an awl. It's not moving that fast, right? So they're teaching slow in the water, but they're teaching boat to water speed, to pull the speed of the boat. And then they teach quick to the front because this thing slows down right away. Right? So the opposite tempo. You know, we were one, two, three, and they're going one, two, three. One, two, three. Makes sense. So when I started working with Gerard, I was like, oh, man, I get it, you know? And a lot of the teams who did well back in the day were very efficient teams. You know, they grabbed the water, they waited for the boat to come. But anyway, I felt like Tahiti came in about 12 years ago with a high stroke rate. But going 10 and a half miles an hour, Molokai, 4 hours, what's the record? 420? 22 or something, right?
Yeah, pretty close.
Around there. So 41 miles, they go all over the place. They're averaging 10 miles an hour. 72 strokes a minute is what they hammer to get on the boat. And then, you know, you watch these guys in their longer pieces or in those iron races, their rate's low. But 72 strokes a minute, 10 miles an hour, then we had the whole country doing 72 strokes a minute no matter what speed you pulled it. So I got women's teams going 6 miles an hour, 72 strokes a minute. And these guys are almost going. So stroke rate for maybe 10 and a half miles an hour, was there 70? Sometimes, depending. And then, you know, so you look at it, like, stroke rate of 8 miles an hour, what should that be? 65, right? I mean, it just kind of goes down if you're just being efficient. So, for me, it was good because I went in, I worked with women's teams a lot because I like working with women. That it can be a pain in the neck, but if you teach them properly, you give them the guidance, they'll work like hell for you, right? It's kind of fun. And then there were, you know, teams I'm working with are winning at 60 strokes a minute. Dana Point broke the record for Catalina a couple years ago. The women, 62 in max. Right? Yeah. NAC guys had pretty low rate. They're winning races in California. Outrigger women right now are doing really well for a young team, and they're level rate. So, it's boat speed, efficiency to, you know, what's going on. As long as, and it's nice to see certain teams now, kind of going, oh, let's wake up, because when the Tahitians came in, I called 12 years ago, the one that first Molokai was flat. And the Tahitians used to only win when it was flat. Big rate, fast stroke rate, crazy guys, smoke cigarettes on that stroke rate. I mean, it was retarded, right? But they came, last time they came, they started winning again. The technique was beautiful. So I was coaching outrigger, they went right by us, and I thought, holy mackerel. To me, in my mind, I said, it looks like a Hungarian K4, which was the best in the world. The timing was flawless. Technique was beautiful. So they win by 15, 20 minutes, whatever it was. And everybody goes, oh, they won because it was flat. Right? Next year they came, was rough. They won again. Everybody went, they're on drugs. Right? Next year they came, they broke their own record. Everybody says, because they don't work for a living, they paddle for a living. Okay, here's the reason they're winning is because they're paddling better than us. They're passionate about it. Fit. They don't, do they have drug testing? Who knows, right?